Sunday morning in Jerusalem, 3 days since Jesus died for our sin, but something happened at the tomb where he lay. He came forth when the stone
there's a thousands and thousands and thousands of religions in the world. Thousands, literally thousands. And only one claims to have died and rose from the dead. Only one. And that's why we're here this morning, is to worship the risen Lamb. I have thought so much this week about this day. Last week we preached on the busy week that Christ had, and I have thought about those days and thought about those days and what he went through and what he was going to go through, and then think about today. I love it, Sunday's coming. I just love that phrase, Sunday's coming. And it's here. He rose from the dead. I was up early this morning. I deliberately wanted to look out my window and watch the sun come up, and my heart just is about to burst to think, he rose from the dead. No other has ever made that claim and made it come to pass except the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. What a day. What a day. We want to welcome you and thank you for being here on this special day as We always think Sunday's a special day around here, but especially this day that we have set aside to worship the Lord and call it Resurrection Sunday and realize and understand and believe that He rose from the dead. What a day. What a day. My heart's full of gratitude. Let's ask God's blessing then. We're going to stand and sing, He Lives Because He Does. Let's ask Him to bless and let's worship Him and thank Him in prayer. Father, we pause for a moment. And Lord, that heart, that my heart is so stirred, so moved by the song and so the truth of it. Thank you that you're not dead. We're not praying to a dead stone or a stick or some dead man somewhere in a tomb. But we're praying and worshiping a living Savior. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for the death, the burial, and thank you for the resurrection. Lord, what a special day we're set aside. Special day in our country. Special day in the world, actually, to think about the Savior that rose from the dead. I pray for every single person that's in this room that you would move and work in their hearts. I pray they'd be touched today by the Holy Ghost. I pray that somehow, some way, you'll move upon their hearts and they might make a decision, might make a movement toward you today. Lord, I'd ask that everything in this room would be said and done to glorify you and praise you. There'd be no flesh exalted in this room. I pray the Holy Spirit of God would do something very special in this place. Save that which one is lost. Lord, surely there's someone in this room that's lost, never truly trusted Christ. May you draw them to yourself today. Again, thank you for our visitors. Thank you for all those that are here and faithful folks. And Lord, we just want to worship you and thank you, heart full of gratitude. Thank you for saving us. Thank you for dying for us. Most of all, thank you for rising from the dead. We love you and thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said amen. Amen. Let's stand if you wouldn't mind, and we're going to sing He Lives because He Does. And let's worship Him this morning. Would you do that? And this song will help us to do that very thing.
I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. He lives within my heart.
I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy. I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always here. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with
just for emphasis, we could just drop the instrument at that last chorus and just lift our voice and think about it. Because this is the day, one day a year, we really emphasize it. He lives every day. But this is the day we emphasize it. Maybe we could just lift our voices on that last chorus and drop instruments drop out. There's nothing, I think, sweeter than a congregational group of people singing. I love a choir. I love single specials, whatever. But there's something about congregational people lifting their voices. Think about it. We all can't sing. Ask me how I know. But together, we sound wonderful. Amen? Let's sing of that, would you?
On that chorus.
He lives, he lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, he lives. Salvation to impart.
Singing. You may be seated. Our choir is going to sing for us again. There Rose a Lamb.
It was the pandemic.
that doesn't stir your heart, I don't know what will. Don't know what will. Well, if you have a bulletin there handy, we have just a few announcements, things coming up here in the life of Twin City Baptist Church. The reason we do what we do is because He rose. If He didn't rise, we'd have no reason to be here. This evening, there will not be evening service, so spend time with your family, celebrate the risen Lord, and then we'll be back in our places on Wednesday evening with our Awana and children's services and everything going on. We have our men's fellowship Wednesday morning, April the 19th at 9 o'clock right here at the church. There's a sign-up sheet in the foyer for that. And then our Lydia ladies Thursday evening, April the 21st at 6:30 p.m. There's details in the bulletin for that on who's hosting it and where that'll be. And then our youth service on April the 30th, that's Sunday night, our Sunday evening service, the last Sunday of the month. Our youth will take over the evening service. They'll do all the singing, they'll do the offering, the preaching, everything. And if you like having your heart stirred like it is this morning, come out on the 30th because you'll get another dose of it two times in 1 month. And then coming up in May, we've got our Monday night revival meetings in May. We'll have different preachers each Monday night on May the 1st, May the 8th, May 15th, and May the 22nd. We'll have a meal at 5:30 here at the church, and then the service will be 7 on the dot on Monday nights in May. I know that'll be a huge encouragement and a blessing. So make note on your calendar on those four Monday evenings coming up in May. Visitors, we are glad you're here. We're glad you chose to be with us. You could have chose to be anywhere else, but the Lord brought you here, and I think that was for a reason. So we are very glad you're here. Home folks, we're glad you're here as well. Take just a moment, greet the visitors that are around you and those that are surrounding you. Children, come up, greet our pastor, and then we'll come back and sing. All right, as you make your way back to your seat, we're going to sing this chorus, "For God so loved the world, He gave His only Son." That's the reason He came to die, is to die for our sin, that we could one day live with Him. That's what this song is talking about. For God so loved the world.
For God so loved the world, He gave His only Son to die on Calvary's tree, from sin to set me free. Someday He's coming back. What glory that will be. Wonderful His love to me.
Amen. You may be seated. I'm going to ask the men to come along. That song they just sang, the choir, sparked a thought. And we said Christianity is the only religion that's got the leader still living. The others have died. A part of that song, when she sang, "He chose the place and He chose the hour," was prophetic. That's even proof He's the right one. Isaiah told us when, where. The book of Joel told us when and where. Bethlehem would be the place, and the day you died would be the hour. That's prophetic. That's even yet confirmation. We are serving a risen Savior. 4,000 years before. Think of that. Not the day before. Years before. That's even more proof. Man, I'm excited. That song service, I love it. I felt like we were in the presence of the Lord, honestly. I love that place. I love that part when I was there. Yeah, I was there. I was there when the Lord visited me and drew me to Himself and called me a sinner, and I said, yes. And He said, I'm Christ who died for your sins, and I said, I'll take it. Amen. Amen. What a day. What a day. Thank God. I never got over. I went to Calvary February the 22nd of 1998, and I've never got over it. Brother Jim took me to Calvary, not literally, spiritually. He opened the gospel door and kicked me out. And there I stood at the cross, and I saw Him bleeding and dying for me. Personally, I saw it for me. He died for me. He died for you. What a God. Father, we pause. My heart truly is full of gratitude this morning. Thank you for the choir and those that sang specials. Miss Janet, Miss Pinky, and all the specials, and Miss Kelly playing, and all that took place just a few minutes ago. Thank you for that moment of time when we realize and understand what you've done for us, not just in your death, not just in your sinless life, but in your resurrection. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Pray you bless this offering now and use it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Life is worth the living just because he lives. Our pastor is going to come. He's going to open God's word to us here in just a moment. Right before he does, I'm going to sing a song, Arise, My Love. Not a word was heard at the tomb that day, just the shuffling of soldiers' feet as they guarded the grave. One day, 2 days, 3 days had passed. Could it be that Jesus had breathed his last? Could it be that his father had forsaken him, turned his back on his son, despising our sin? All hell seemed to whisper, just forget him, he's dead. Then the father looked down to his son and said, Arise, my love, arise, my love. The grave no longer has a hold on you. No more death sting, no more suffering. Arise, arise, my love. The earth trembled and the tomb began to shake, and like lightning from heaven, the stone rolled away. And as dead men, the guards stood there in fright, as the power of love displayed its might. Then suddenly a melody filled the air, riding wings of love, it was everywhere. The words all creation had been longing to hear, the sweet sound of victory so loud and clear. Arise, my love, arise, my love. The grave no longer has a hold on you. No more death sting, no more suffering. Arise, arise. Sin, where are your shackles? Death, where is your sting? Hell has been defeated. The grave could not hold the king. Arise, my love, arise, my love. The grave no longer has a hold on you. No more death sting, no more suffering. Arise, arise, arise.
My brother. Yes, sir. Arise. Well, if you have your Bibles there, turn with me to Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24. Again, I want to extend a thank you for being here and on this special day. And I want to encourage you to not only take this day, but start. Let this be a launching pad. Let this be a launching pad from your Christian life. And let not just be today, let it be a determination, intentional to serve the Lord, not just today. I appreciate what this day means. But I would encourage you to be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Be a part of what God's doing in this world. In Luke chapter 24, I'm always a little bit uneasy or skeptical. I don't know really sometimes if I should preach on Easter. Should I preach on creation? Should I preach on hell? Should I preach on heaven? I mean, I'm just sort of whatever the Lord leads. But I did get something when I began studying the past week out of Luke 24. We preached last week on Luke 23. on the busy week that the Lord Jesus had, and we studied and looked at that and saw his busy week, and I literally did think of that, and I know it probably sounds a little biased, but even though I preached it all week, I thought Monday, what was he doing? Tuesday, what was he doing? Wednesday, I had that on my mind all week. I really did. I thought about his day and what we were doing as a family and what he would have been doing. And, of course, I was enjoying my life and I was out recreational and he was out suffering. And the comparison of his life and his week compared to ours is not even in comparison. And I thought that's one of the reasons I love him so much is because of what he's done for me. He suffered. He bled. He died. And I got to thinking about some things out of Luke 24, and I just want to give you a couple truths out of it. And of course, we all know the Easter story, and we've all heard preaching on Easter. But I want to give you a thought this morning on this thought, an expensive Easter. An expensive Easter. And I've done a little study, and you probably already know this, but it's estimated that $24 billion a year is spent on Easter. $24 billion. $1.4 billion is spent on candy. Think of that. 80% of Americans will spend an average $192 on Easter this year. It only holds second, one of the most, but only holds second to Christmas. Nearly $900 billion is spent on Christmas. Then it dawned on me, those two holidays circle around our Savior. Christmas being his birth and resurrection being his Easter. And I thought, interesting about that, but here's what's happened. The world has taken that holiday and made money on it. They've taken what we would call sacred, what we would call very spiritual, very sacred. They've taken it and made a dollar from it. And they've understood, man, we can sell right here. We can sell Easter. We can sell a Christmas. We can sell bunny rabbits and Easter candy and chocolate bunnies. And we can sell all those things and make a bunch of money. And they've done just that. But then you turn the coin and you realize what he spent for you. We give our money to everything, and I've said this before, if you want to check your heart, just check your bank ledger. And that'll tell you where your heart is, because the scripture says where your treasure is, that's where your heart will be. Your heart follows your checkbook. Your heart follows what you pay for and what you buy and what you give to. And I get to thinking about Easter, and I thought about the money that is spent and the expense that people put forth for Easter. And we all get new clothes, and we all get new shoes, and we all buy an outfit. We all do all these kinds of things, which is absolutely fine. And I'm not preaching against them because I got a new suit on this morning. It'd be sort of hypocritical to do that, wouldn't it? So I'm with you. I'm with you. I'm for you. But let's not forget what it cost him. Let's not forget the expense he paid that Easter might take. Because think of it, if he hadn't arose from the dead, we wouldn't be here on Easter. If he not rose from the dead, if he had not been buried and rose from the dead, it would all be in vain for us to be here this morning. It's amazing. Very lucrative, very, very lucrative holiday. But in Luke chapter 24, if you'll read just a few verses with me, and I'll give you the thought on this expensive Easter, and let's see what it cost him. Let's see what he did to make it come to pass. The Bible says in verse number 1 of Luke 24, now upon the first day of the week, I always like to stop and say there's a doctrinal statement in that. That's why we worship on Sunday morning and not on Saturday. He rose from the dead on the first day of the week. Sunday is your first day of the week. Monday is not. Monday is for our work day. Monday is our cultural day. But he rose from the dead on Sunday morning. He rose from the dead. Think of that. Get that nailed down in your mind and in your heart a mile deep. The Bible says now, upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulcher, bringing the spices which they had prepared and certain others with them. And when they had found the stone rolled away from the sepulcher, I just want to pause here for a minute. I don't know when they turned the corner. I don't know when they saw the stone. I don't know when it came into view. But I do know when they saw that stone moved away, they knew something had happened. They understood this is not normal. There was Romans or the centurion soldiers there and had a Roman seal on that rock, and there's no way it could be moved. There's no way it could have been rolled out of the way. It took multiple people to roll that stone in front of that mouth of that grave, and so it had to be a supernatural. It had to be a supernatural movement of God. There'd be no way that that thing could be moved out of the way. And when they saw that thing, we'll see it here in just a minute in verse 4. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed, as we would be too. He died, yes. He's in that tomb, yes. They rolled the stone back. One man said they didn't roll it for him to get out. They rolled it that they might go in. And they went in and they saw, I love that scene, and you can read more accounts of it, but when they walk into that open tomb, when they walk into that empty tomb and see those white men, those white apparel, men with white apparel, and they see them in there, they're so perplexed. The Bible says it this way. He says they were much perplexed thereabout. Behold, two men stood by them in shining garments, and they were afraid. So they were perplexed and they were afraid. And notice what the Bible says, verse number 5, and bowed down their faces to the earth. I might remind you that that's what we'll do when we see him. Every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Every single person. From the president to the homeless person on the street. Every single person will bow their knee to Christ. And they will confess. And I see this here, and they walk in. They're perplexed. They're afraid. They are not sure what's going on. And here's what the two men say to them. Why seek ye the living among the dead? He's not here, but he's risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinners, sinful men, and be crucified, and the third day rise again. Verse number 7 is a prophetic statement. Verse number 7, he's telling them prior to his death, he tells them in the book of John, when he's really sitting them down and teaching them, he says, listen, you are going, I'm going to die. As the song said, he chose the place, he chose the hour. They didn't murder him. He gave his life. He laid down his life for you and for me. He willingly gave of himself. He willingly gave of his life. I thought this some years ago. I had a friend of mine, his daddy needed a kidney. And he, his son, gave his dad a kidney. And he donated his kidney to his son. Son gave him to his dad. And I thought, what a commendable thing that was for somebody to give organ that way that they might live a more healthy life. And then I heard a fella here that had a heart transplant, and how the doctors took a heart out of a human being that had passed away, and moments later put it in another human being that person might go on living a normal life. And still yet, living and moving and have his being, because somebody gave their heart, literally, physically, gave their heart to another individual that they might live. I remember talking to that man, and he's in surgery, and he's in preparation time, and there's a certain part of that surgery that you're in sort of limbo. You're waiting on the person to die. How odd would that be? Laying there in the bed, watching TV, and hear a helicopter land on top of the hospital. Could that be it? Not that one. 30 minutes later, a helicopter land on the hospital. Would it be that one? And I don't know the feeling come over that man, but it just moves my heart, even yet standing here thinking I'm sitting here waiting on someone to die that I might live. And them come in with that container and walk into that room and say, we've got it. You know what that means. Somebody had to die. And may God, by the Holy Spirit, make an application this morning that somebody had to die that you might live. Somebody had to give his life that you might live. Somebody might have to die that we might go on living forever and forever and forever. Oh, he gave us his heart. Absolutely. He gave it physically for you and for me. No wonder they're perplexed. No wonder they're afraid. No wonder they're bowing their faces to the earth. The Bible says in verse number 7, he said in verse number 8, and they remembered his words. And they returned from the sepulchre, verse number 9, and told all these things unto the 11 and all to, and to the rest. And it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary the mother of James and the other women that were with him. Can I stop here and just brag on you ladies just for a minute? There's not a man mentioned in that group. Hey, I'm going to preach here just a second. You hold on, fellas. You'll search your church, you'll find probably 3-1 women in church than you will men. That's a disgrace. You know what's wrong with our country? Women have to take up the slack because men won't. I got one amen right there. I know it's Easter, but it's still true. Men are going off by the wayside. Where is Christian manhood? Where is Christian men that will rise up? We've been talking about getting some of these things started, mentoring men and mentoring boys. And kids don't even know how to change a tire and check their oil. And where's the men? Where's the men of our society will raise children and raise boys and girls and be the father figure that is needed in the home? Where is those people? They've abandoned the family. They've abandoned the cause of Christ. And here we find that very thing was happening on the cross. And so we have a supernatural spiritual day on hand. We have that nothing has ever happened. And we find here there's a group of women, very passionate women, very dedicated women, very consecrated women to the Lord. The Bible says, verse number 10, it was Mary Magdalene. I'm really interested in meeting Mary Magdalene when I get to heaven. She has got to be a fascinating somebody. She is somebody that had 7 devils in her. She was exorcised, baby. The exorcist come about her. Basically, the Lord Jesus Christ cast 7 demons out of that woman. There's no telling what she was involved in. There's no telling what she was sunken in. She met Christ. Christ saved her, changed her life, and changed a whole course. That's what Jesus is about. That's what Jesus does. I'm really interested in Mary Magdalene when I get to heaven. I'm really interested in what her life was like and what God brought her from when he saved her. And Joanna, we don't know much about Joanna, the Mary, the mother of James, and the other women that were with them. And there's a whole host of women. And we talk about Cleopas' wife, and there's Ananias and Sapphira. There's a whole host of recorded ladies for us in the Scripture that God exalted because of their service. Service to him. And praise God for the Christian woman that wants to serve the Lord. Praise God for the Christian ladies that say, I want to do something for God. It's exactly what we find here. But I think about chapter 24, and I love the resurrection. I love that he bled and died on the cross. I love that, and I love that he died for me, and I'm so thankful that I don't have to go to hell, and he took my sin debt for me, and praise God for that. But you know, it cost him some things. It cost him some humiliation. It cost him some mockery. I mean, we said this last week. He endured denial. He endured mockery. He endured spitting in someone's face. I've said this so many times, and I just can't really get over it. There's nothing more disgusting than anything could ever happen to a human being than be spit in someone's face. And they spit in the Lord Jesus' face. Smacked him across the face and plucked his beard. It cost him humiliation. It cost him mockery. It cost him denial. It cost him thievery. It cost him all these things that he had to endure. But yet, he took it for you and for me. And I got to studying what it cost him. But then I got to thinking about it. He gained some things. He gained the salvation of millions that would come to him. The thief on the cross. Remember last week we looked at Zacchaeus? He left Jericho. When he left Jericho, he led Zacchaeus to the Lord, to himself. And so he left there and he went in to the city and started leading people to himself. And then the thief on the cross and then all the multitudes that we are not recorded for us. So there's no telling how many he led to Christ that day or led to himself that day. And so we understand that he gained a lot. He gained millions. He gained those that would come trust him as their Savior. If you're here today and you're a Christian, you're a believer, you have had to put your faith and trust in Christ. Let me say this, you were not born a believer. You did not come from your womb a believer. You come from the womb a sinner. You come from the womb. You were. I know it's hard for you mamas to believe this, but it's true. That little baby that was come from your womb is a sinner. I know it's hard to believe that. And you didn't believe that until it was about two. And then there's like, yeah, they are sinners. Little liars, little thieves. Little sinners. I remember, hey, I've been there with you. I remember our firstborn. I told that doctor and nurse, I said, there's no way that boy can be a sinner. That didn't take long. We're born sinners. We're born from the womb speaking lies, the Bible says. There's not a one of us are going to get to heaven without being born again. John 3:18 says, you must be born again. George Whitfield, they kept asking him, George, why do you keep preaching John 3:18? You must be born again. He said, because you must be born again. It's simple. You must recognize that Jesus Christ bled and died on the cross for you. And you must recognize you're a sinner. You can't get there by your good works. You can't get there by your baptism certificate. You can't get there by your church membership. You can only get there by the shed blood of Jesus Christ and put your faith and trust in Him. Period. Nothing will get you there. God says not one dime will redeem your soul. Not one. He said in Hebrews chapter 12, listen to this verse. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse number 2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Listen to this verse. This verse has always caused me just to... Who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. What caused Christ to continue you and me? Who for the joy, notice what it says, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. That, beloved, is what he said he was doing for you and because of you. I was thinking about appraisal. You know, we're living in a society where everything's appraised. Your house is appraised, your car is appraised. You know what appraise is? The biggest lie word ever heard. Appraisal means nothing unless somebody's willing to pay for it. I could say these glasses, I appraise these glasses at being worth $10,000 because I wore them. I don't make a hill of beans if no one's willing to pay it. Think of your salvation. What's the appraisal on your salvation? What's your soul worth? Well, Jesus said it's worth his blood. He said, what's the soul of a man worth? Jesus said, I'll show you. And he hung himself on the cross. And he shed his precious blood for you. I thought about that expense. I thought about appraisal. I thought about those things that cost us. I thought about something in his life, his appearance. I think it cost him his appearance. You know, you read Psalm 22. I was at a funeral yesterday. And we typically, fellas and preachers, whoever, will read Psalm 23. That's a sort of a go-to, which is fine. And as he read Psalm 22, as I was listening to him read that, and I've always said this, why do we go to Psalm 22? I mean, Psalm 23, excuse me, Psalm 23. He was reading Psalm 23. Why do we always go to Psalm 23? Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He He sets a table for my enemies. I'm not getting all of it, but you got it. Why is Psalm 23 so strong? Because Psalm 22. See, we would not have a Savior if He had not suffered. In Psalm 22, He suffers. In Psalm 22, it's like a man taking a pen out and writing out what he's watching on the cross. You ought to take some time when you get cold and indifferent toward the things of God. Just read Psalm 22. The Bible says you couldn't even tell it like a human being. They plowed up on my back, the Bible says, like furrows up my back. They took a Roman cat of nine tails with nine leather straps with glass and steel and lead balls into those leather straps. And they would wrap those leather straps around his back while his hands were tied above his head on the whipping post. And those things would lash around his waist and his midsection and pull those things from him. That's when he said in Psalm 22, I look upon my bones and my bones stare upon me. He took all that for you and for me. He gave His appearance. Let's just be honest. How many would give their appearance for salvation? Let's honest. You don't have to answer it, but just honestly think in your mind. Would I give up what I look like for someone else? We spend a lot of money on appearance, don't we? I mean, how many of us are sitting in the mirror this morning? When you got five girls in the house, you don't get to no mirror in my house. They in my mirror. Don't y'all have y'all's own room? Yeah, Dad, but I just like yours better. Comb it back. Looking it all up, right? Why? Because we want the appearance, right? There'd be very few of us that would give the appearance for the salvation of somebody else. But Jesus Christ gave of Himself, not just in His blood, but as an appearance. He gave of Himself for you and for me. He'd be willing to give up what He looked like for your salvation. My heart goes out when I think about a disfigured body. My heart goes out to American military. And I thank them often. Several years ago, I got to be a part of Habitat Humanity down the valley to help build a house. And I remember that fellow that they were building the house for. He had no legs. He had a motorized wheelchair, and it was like a four-wheel drive kind of thing. It was rent everywhere. It's like all-terrain. And he would go everywhere on that four-wheeler thing looking. And I thought, man, that's a cool little ride, you know, run up, down. But I wouldn't give my legs for it. But he gave his legs in the military. He gave him himself. He gave him his appearance. He gave him his handicap. He gave up those things that you and I might have freedom. Thank God for our American military. Thank God for the men and women that are fighting in harm's way at this moment. Many of them in this room that have fought and put themselves in a situation where they're defending and giving up their appearance and taking away from what they like or what they don't like for the others' freedom, for the others' sacrifice. Thank God for His appearance that He gave up. Thank God that He not only gave up His eternal life and came down, He gave up His earthly life. John 15:13 says, no greater love hath no man than this, than a man lay down his life for his friends. I mean, honestly, if you're an unbeliever in this room, you may be an atheist, I don't know, but I would highly encourage you, just examine, not his spiritual life, just examine his physical life. Just take out the facts, cold hard facts out of the Scripture and just show us what he was as a human being. Just physical facts about his life and what he did. And you'd have to say, according to Scripture, this is truly the Son of God. That's exactly what the Roman soldier said when he bent down. There's always a moving phrase that maybe I can find it right quick. It has no notes on it, but I thought it was a wonderful, if I can find it, on the crucifixion. When the Scripture says, truly this was the Son of God. Truly this was when he was beating those nails into his hands, when he was beating those spikes into his feet, when he saw the blood running off his face and he smelt that smell of spikenard upon him as that alabaster box was broken upon his body some days before, maybe some hours before, and as he beat those spikes into his hands and into his feet, and that smell and aroma coming off him, that spikenard meant love in the book of Solomon, and he smelt that and seen that blood and beat those stakes and beat those hands, and he laid there like a sheep dumb to the slaughter and didn't say a word. No wonder he said, surely this is the Son of God. Surely, surely this is the salvation that he promised us. He gave us his life, beloved. He gave us his life. No greater love hath no man than this. How can you turn your back on that? I remember getting saved. I remember hearing the gospel two or three times maybe in my life. The third time, maybe the second or third time, I trusted Christ as my Savior. And Brother Jim preached the gospel just like I'm preaching to you this morning. And he said, if you'd like to get saved, and I got saved, I trusted Christ as my Savior. And I came down and was just thanking God that morning. And I stood to my feet and I said to Brother Jim, just audibly, that's before I knew anything about altar call. I was just raw, you know. And I said, why don't everybody get saved? I mean, think about it. Think about a man bleeding, dying on the cross. Thinking about a shed blood. Thinking about him having not to do this and didn't have to do it, but did it anyway and died on the cross sacrificially, innocent, did nothing wrong. And all you have to do is accept and believe that Jesus Christ bled and died on the cross. Why don't everybody get saved? He gave up his earthly life. And in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 12, he gave of his blood. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. That's the reason the baptism doesn't do it. Look, if your good works could get you there, the blood would be no good. If what you did or what you did not do got you there, then what I'm preaching to you is would be all in vain. It's got to be the blood. He said in Hebrews 9:12, neither by the blood of bulls and goats, not by the goats and calves, but by his own blood. By his own blood, church. He entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal, not partial, eternal redemption for us. I'm trying to preach elementary theology to you. If this is just about as bottom shelf as I can get, Jesus died on the cross. He gave his life for you. He shed his precious blood for you. And if you trust him as your Savior, you go to heaven. That's as elementary as I can put it. That's just as simple as it is. He gave of his appearance. He gave of his life. He gave of his blood. I thought about that expensive Easter that day. He gave everything he had for you and for me. I wrote this quote down and I'll close. The price he paid is proof of what he thought of you. The price that he paid. I guarantee you, anything that you've ever paid a lot for, you have protected it. You think of your most expensive possession. Your house, your car, I don't know. Hope you say your wife. That'd be a good one, wouldn't it? Well, possession, that's a little fuzzy there, isn't it? Not about a possession, but think of the most expensive thing that you own and the extent you go to protect that and what you would go to keep it safe and the price he paid for your redemption and my redemption is the proof of what he loves, how he loves you. That's what compels me to stand up here Sunday by Sunday and go out in the highways and hedges and tell people about Christ and stand on funerals and tell people, you better know that you know. Just yesterday, I helped carry a man to his grave. My hands were on the casket and tears dripping off my face. Because 7 days prior to yesterday, he was standing in my driveway talking horses, talking this and talking. Just he pulled right in. We had a conversation, had a laughing and cutting up and giggling and talking. 66 years old. Had a great conversation. That was on Saturday. I never dreamed that I'd get a message on Wednesday that he died. And 7 days to the day, I was carrying his casket to the grave. You don't know. And it's always a sting. It's always a sting of death. I don't think so much for the one dying or the one that's dead, is it for us? Oh, sting, where is thy? Oh, grave, where is thy sting? Oh, let's pray together.